Assalamu alaikum everyone, and welcome to a new ATP video. Today we'll be talking about the gram-negative bacteria that have a diplococcus arrangement. Probably the only pathogenic bacteria that have this arrangement is Neisseria. Neisseria has two main important species. The first one is Neisseria meningitidis, and the second one is Neisseria gonorrhoeae.
In this video, we'll talk about Neisseria gonorrhoeae.
But first, let's start with the shared features between these two species. First of all, they're both gram-negative diplococci. And second of all, they are both oxidase positive. For the lab stuff, Neisseria species grow on chocolate agar. But what is that? Do we actually use chocolate? No, not really. Neisseria species can grow on blood agar because it's inhibited by some of the elements in the blood agar. However, when we heat the blood agar, these inhibitory elements become inactive and thus Neisseria can grow. This heated blood is in fact the famous chocolate agar. The other medium that we use for Neisseria's growth is Thayer Martin agar, which is selective agar that only allows Neisseria species to grow while inhibiting other organisms from growing. This is also known as VCN agar, referring to the antibiotics used to inhibit the other organisms, which are vancomycin, colistin, and nystatin. Now let's move to the shared virulence factors. First, we have pili, which allows attachment to mucosal surfaces. These pili also display antigenic variation, which makes it difficult for our immune system to target, because as you know, they always change their camouflage. Then we have IgA protease, which will cleave IgA antibodies at its hinge point. This facilitates Neisseria survival along the mucosal surfaces, because if you remember, IgA antibodies are found predominantly at the mucosal surfaces. Since Neisseria meningitidis is a gram-negative bacteria, he has the ability of producing endotoxin. But be aware that Neisseria endotoxin is a little bit different than the original one that you already know about. It has a lipooligosaccharide instead of the lipopolysaccharide in the previous examples. You can think of it as an alternative version of the lipopolysaccharide found in other gram-negative bacteria. Lastly, you need to know that patients with C5 to C9 deficiency, also known as terminal complement deficiency, are more susceptible to Neisseria infection because these particular complement proteins are essential to form the MAC, or also known as membrane attack complex, that is usually used to cause bacteriolysis. So when these proteins are deficient, the MAC won't be produced enough, and that will cause them to be more prone to infections. Now let's focus on Neisseria gonorrhoeae. First, remember that Neisseria gonorrhoeae does not ferment maltose and does not have polysaccharide capsule like Neisseria meningitidis. Now let's discuss the pathogenesis of Neisseria gonorrhoeae infection. Neisseria gonorrhoeae can affect both men and women and result in gonorrhoeae infection. Let's start with men first. A man can acquire Neisseria gonorrhoeae by having unprotected sexual intercourse with infected individual. After acquiring the infection, Neisseria gonorrhoeae will first damage the urethra and cause inflammation, or urethritis, and they will present with painful urination along with purulent discharge. The infection can get complicated and cause prostatitis and epididymitis. Although some men remain asymptomatic, they can still pass the infection to other sexual partners. Now let's move on to the ladies. Like men, women can develop urethritis and present with painful urination and purulent discharge. However, unlike men, a large percentage of women will remain asymptomatic. In addition to urethritis, Neisseria gonorrhoeae can also affect the cervix and cause inflammation or cervicitis. Again, a large percentage of these women will remain asymptomatic. However, some will present with lower abdominal discomfort, dyspareunia or pain with sexual intercourse, and purulent vaginal discharge. What is important to remember here is that the infection of the cervix can ascend and cause pelvic inflammatory disease, also known as PID, which is inflammation of the uterus, fallopian tube, and the ovaries. PID patient usually presents with fever, lower abdominal pain, abnormal menstrual bleeding, and cervical motion tenderness. Cervical motion tenderness is the pain that is elicited when the cervix is moved by the doctor's examining finger. And cervical motion tenderness is a very important clinical sign for PID, so you have to look for it. It's good to note here that the presence of intrauterine device, which is used as contraception, increases the risk of progression to PID. Okay, now let's focus on the possible complications of PID. First, we have infertility. And the way this happens is that you form scar tissue in the fallopian tube, which can block it, and that would prevent the egg from meeting the sperm. Secondly, we have scarring and ectopic pregnancy. Do you know where is the most common site for ectopic pregnancy to happen? Take a moment. The ampulla of the fallopian tube. Then we have peritonitis. This is when the infection spreads from the fallopian tube and into the peritoneal fluid. Lastly, we have Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome, in which the infection spreads to the liver capsule, resulting in formation of adhesions between the liver capsule and the peritoneum. And these adhesions are called violet string adhesions. Also, in men and women, Neisseria gonorrhoeae can cause septic arthritis. This happens when Neisseria gonorrhoeae spreads into the blood and causes inflammation of the joints. Typically, septic arthritis caused by Neisseria gonorrhoeae affects more than one joint, which is why it's called polyarthritis. And in addition to that, the condition is usually associated with skin lesions and tenosynovitis, or inflammation of the muscle tendon. Now, for the last clinically relevant information about Neisseria gonorrhoeae, you should know that it can affect neonates as well. The infection is transmitted from infected pregnant woman to her baby during delivery, through the birth canal, which would then affect the eyes and result in inflammation of the conjunctiva, also known as purulent conjunctivitis. The symptoms start to appear within 5 days after delivery. In contrast, purulent conjunctivitis caused by chlamydia is usually delayed beyond that. Now for the treatment, we usually use ceftriaxone and azithromycin. Ceftriaxone is a third-generation cephalosporin, and azithromycin is a macrolide. For prevention, we sadly don't have a vaccine for the species yet. Do you know why? It's because of the antigenic variation that the pili display. And that's all you need to know about Neisseria gonorrhoeae. Please give us your feedback so we can improve in the next videos. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to get our latest videos. And as always, thanks for watching.